Now we'd like to bring up someone who works in the industry and put a real face on this industry, and that's Lorenda Overman. Lorenda Overman is a farm leader, a farm wife from Wayne County. Lorenda, come up.
Thank you, President Wooten. You all must be good Methodists because you're sitting way in the back. My husband is the best one of all, way back there on the back row. I was not raised on a farm. I was raised in urban Goldsboro, which is in Wayne County. You saw us on the back of your card. I know what it's like in both worlds. I know how it was growing up. My daddy worked 9 to 5. We had supper every night at 6 o'clock. You could bank on it. We all played in the yard with the neighborhood children after school. We didn't have anything else to do. We had regular and planned vacations and a predictable schedule. You knew on the 4th of July you were not going to work. You knew Christmas Day you were not going to work. Then I met my farmer husband and found out what living on the farm was like. We fell in love, and I love him dearly, but I love our way of life just as much. We no more 9 to 5 days, no more. We now work together 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Sometimes he's the boss and sometimes I'm the boss. Our crops and our livestock dictate our schedule every day. We go Christmas tree shopping when it rains because you can't pick soybeans in the rain. We go to the beach when it rains because you can't be in the field when it rains. We take time off usually in February when everybody else is working. And we usually work several hours before breakfast. And if I don't take supper to the field, we eat about 9 or 9:30 every night. But I love and embrace this way of life. It has raised my children. It has put food on our table and clothes on our backs for years. Our children love this way of life. Two of them have chosen other professions, but one of them is still agricultural related. The third one has just now returned to the farm after graduating from college. She and her husband want to work on our farm. But through working together on our farm, they've learned responsibility. They've learned the value of a family pulling together. I wish I could tell you how many times at the end of the day they sat around the table at 9:30 at night and talked about what had happened that day and just laughed and joked and shared together, and it just warms your heart. They've learned flexibility. Nothing ever works the way you thought it was going to work, so therefore they've learned problem solving. They've also learned to love the earth and respect nature. Oh, one more thing. When you all are planning your vacations in the summer and you're praying that it won't rain, I'm at my house praying that my corn crop gets at least 1 inch of rain a week. So that's why your vacations get wet sometimes and God smiles on me. And that's why sometimes my corn crop goes lacking and God smiles on you. My farmer is, and I are fifth generation farmers. He can trace his farm family heritage back before the Civil War. And so our daughter and her husband make the sixth generation in our family farm. And over the years that's changed. My father-in-law used to grow hogs on the ground out in the woods. I'm sure that some of you remember what that was like. Hauling water to make sure it didn't freeze in the winter, hauling feed, walking the hot wire fences to make sure there wasn't a branch laying across and those little pigs get out and run out in the woods and you never find them again. My husband says an animal has one goal in life, and that is to get to the other side of the fence. Then in 1978, they decided to change their operation a little bit, and we went to confinement hog operations. We built a few hog buildings, and we put our hogs in there, and we became what is commonly known as a fair-to-finish operation, which meant that we bred our sows, we gestated our sows, we birthed our pigs, and we grew them out to top in size, which is 260 to 300 pounds. And that cycle went on and on. Every day we bred sows, and every day we birthed pigs. We did that until 2007, making some changes, you know, adding buildings and remodeling buildings. At our peak, we were selling 200 pigs or top hogs a week, which is a transfer truck. When you see a transfer truck riding down the road, it has about 200 hogs in it. So at our peak, we were doing that and we were independent. Then in 2007, disease got so bad in our hogs that we had to modify our operation a little bit, and we went to just growing top hogs. So we remodeled, we went with an integrator, and now we grow top hogs. And so the 7,000 top hogs live in my backyard in their confinement houses. Then a couple of years later, we bought a sow farm, which has 2,000 sows. So every week now, in addition to our top hogs, we wean 850 to 900 pigs every week. So guess what needs water, food, power, sprinklers, and heaters, and coolers every day of the year? And that's my pigs. We also have a row crop operation on our farm. We do corn, wheat, and soybeans. A typical year for us in that, if you start in March, let's start in November. In November, we plant 1,600 acres of wheat every November. That is on what used to be corn land. So we plant our 1,600 acres of wheat in November. Then in March, we plant 1,600 acres of corn. And we follow that immediately by planting about 200 acres of early soybeans. Then we start harvesting that wheat that we planted in November. We start that in May, and immediately behind the wheat, we plant soybeans. Less than a day or 2 days go between the two crops. And you hear farmers refer to double cropping, and that's what double cropping is, two crops on the same land in the same year. So our soybeans go in the ground in May and June, and then we start picking corn in August. Try to get that corn out as early as possible because of our location and the hurricanes. Then in November, we turn around on that corn land and we start planting that wheat again. Now what I've left out is all the spraying that goes and the tillage that goes down, all the extra work that goes in, the fertilizers and things, but that's just our planting schedule. We have very little downtime. And I know you've heard, idle land makes no money. You don't let it sit there without growing something. Farmers make great neighbors in many ways. You've seen and heard the information already. We pay rent or own our own land. So we have an investment in that land. Therefore, we're going to care for it to the very best of our ability. We know what is our success is directly related to the condition of the land. So therefore, we keep the ditches cut. We keep grass waterways. We do no tilling. We practice the no erosion and other environmental friendly practices. Chemicals and fertilizers are very expensive. We're not going to spend that money if we don't have to. We also don't want to over apply and harm that land, which goes back to our success is directly related to the condition of the land. We pay property taxes, but farmland uses very few property tax dollars. You don't need police for farmland, fire for farmland. You don't need water and sewer for farmland. We also protect and manage our forest lands. Farmers also provide the communities that they live in with a very stable, I guess, resident, you want to call us. I've never met a farmer that wasn't rooted and firmly planted in their community. They don't travel. They don't move. They're there. Their parents were there. They're there. And more than likely, their children are going to be there. And you've already heard, too, that agriculture and agribusiness is responsible for 1 in 5 jobs in North Carolina. On our farm, we employ 17 full-time people. Every day, we pay their salaries. And they don't get minimum wage. Most farm workers do not work for minimum wage anymore. Labor is one of the challenges that farmers face. Fewer and fewer people want to work on a farm. It pays pretty good, but it's a lot of hard work, and the hours are not very good. The cost of keeping inputs low and outputs higher than your inputs is also a challenge. When we put a crop in a field, it's about 6 months before we see anything from that crop, and it takes a lot more besides the seed and the tractor fuel to put that crop in the field. Another challenge that I see personally is educating our government officials about the needs of agriculture. Fewer and fewer of our government officials have direct roots to the farm. More and more of them are very removed from agriculture. I've been to D.C. twice since April trying to talk to our senators and our congressmen about how important the Farm Bill is to us, which, by the way, is only 20% Farm Bill and 80% something else. But I've been up there twice to talk about that and the inheritance tax and how it would affect our farmers if it does not stay as it is or get actually lowered would be nice. I also want them to understand that the United States is not a strong country in our food supply. If we don't have a safe and dependable food supply, then that weakens our country. And I want them to know that if we need to be a world power, we need to have a safe food supply. And I also do a lot in schools. I go out and I talk to kindergartners and elementary students all the time about the importance of agriculture. We took a little plastic milk to the kindergartners last week in Wayne County, and we were talking to them about how that one cow, they were milking that one little plastic cow, and they were having a good time. And I said, now this one cow can make 25 gallons of milk, and I had a gallon of milk. And one of the teachers said, good gracious, I didn't know that. So I'm trying to educate as much as possible, and hopefully by educating some children, I'll grab some adults on the way. Agriculture is the number one industry in North Carolina. That's the theme of today, and it employs over 20% of its people. But agriculture is the only industry in the world that you cannot live without. You have to have food and fiber. You have to have it. I'm proud to be a part of an industry with such a rich heritage, and I'm doing my best to make sure that it has a promising future. And have a great day. Thank you.